We'll call the meeting for January 24th to order. City Clerk, if you'd call the roll.
Commissioner Abraham.
Present.
Commissioner Holland.
Present.
Commissioner Rhodes.
Present.
Commissioner Wilson.
Present.
Mayor Harless.
And I do want to say I'm filling in tonight for the mayor. She is attending the Delta Regional Authority Leadership Conference in New Orleans and has been gone a couple of days and traveling home tonight. So we wish her safe travels home. But the DRA has been a good friend to our community recently with a grant for our flood wall and also for the Merriman House. So we're glad that she's down there. She's a graduate of their leadership program, and we're glad she's there with DRA building more relationships for our community. So this is Catholic Schools Week, and we're going to be honoring that in just a few minutes, but we're going to begin with the invocation with Father Brad Whistle, the St. Mary Episcopal Vicar, and then we'll have the Pledge of Allegiance, and I believe that's going to be led by Mr. Sims Parker. Is that right, Parker Sims? Palmer. He was born the same day as my granddaughter, so I was very close, so I did remember that. So Palmer, when he's finished, if you will come up here as well. If everyone will stand.
You are devoted to us as a father, and you show your love and care for us in many, many ways. We are especially thankful for the beauty of your creation in this little portion of the world that we call Paducah, Kentucky. We are grateful for the civil and political leadership that do so much to ensure a good quality of life for the people in this city. Lord, as we begin this new year of 2017, we pray that your blessing will be upon our mayor, Brandy Harless, and the City Commission gathered here this evening. Thank you for their leadership and bless them with your peace and grace. Bless them also with your gifts of wisdom and justice so that all they do might hasten the building of your kingdom in this city and throughout our world. We make this prayer through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen.
Let's come up to the mic.
To the flag of the United States of America, and to its republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Father Whistle, and thank you, Palmer. We appreciate you coming and being here with us. And we do have a proclamation for Catholic Schools Week, recognizing St. Mary's School System. We're really proud to have you all in our community. And we have with us Eleanor Spry, the director of St. Mary's School System, Ashley Wright, the advancement director, Father Whistle, Reagan Mobley, first grade student at St. Mary Elementary School, Edward O'Neill, a fifth grade student at St. Mary Elementary School, Palmer Sims, sixth grade at St. Mary Middle School, and Jacqueline Meredith, a ninth grade student at St. Mary High School. So we appreciate having all of you here, and Henry Wright, also a student at St. Mary School System. Did we miss anyone?
Yeah.
Okay, do you all want to come up here, or do you want to come to Ms. Spry, and then I'll read the proclamation? Okay. If you all want to come here to the mic, and then I'll read it as you can stand over here to the side. I'll come over here to the mic. Well, whereas St. Mary's School System has, since 1858, continuously provided the highest caliber of academic and moral development to those students which they serve for the mutual benefit of every citizen, and whereas Paducah Catholic educators have, throughout our city's history, dedicated and used their talents toward the development of a responsible and spiritually motivated citizenship in preparation for their responsibilities as residents of the city and as members of this society, and whereas those students who have been educated in the St. Mary School System have addressed themselves to the pressing social and moral issues of our day that evoke the fullest measure of the spiritual wealth of our country, and whereas with the theme of Catholic Schools, Communities of Faith, Knowledge, and Service, Catholic schools across the nation are celebrating National Catholic School Week from January 29th through February 4th, 2017. Now, therefore, I, Sandra Wilson, on behalf of Brandy Harless, Mayor of the City of Paducah, Kentucky, do proclaim next week as Catholic Schools Week in the City of Paducah and commend this observance to all of our citizens. So congratulations, and thank you all for being here, and thank you for what you do for our community. Do you want to say something?
I would. Thank you very much. Very short. We are so glad to be a part of the Paducah McCracken County area. We feel like we contribute greatly, and we want to be a part of growth in this area and be an outreach, providing an excellent academic education and a good Catholic faith-based education. And I also want to celebrate this week as School's Choice Week. So if you want more information about that, we'd also be happy to talk to you about that. That's this week as well. Thank you for being here and for the parents that support us.
Thank you again. We really appreciate all that you contribute to our community. Okay, we'll go on with our meeting. Commissioner Abraham.
I move that the reading of the minutes for January 17, 2017, City Commission Meeting be waived, and that the minutes of said meetings prepared by the City Clerk be approved as written.
Second. City Clerk.
Commissioner Abraham.
Aye.
Commissioner Holland.
Aye.
Commissioner Rhodes.
Aye.
Mayor Pro Tem Wilson.
Aye. Commissioner Holland, if you'd read the motion.
I move that the following documents be received and filed. Documents number one, certificates of liability insurance from Fawn Electric Asphalt Paving, MP Lawson Construction, and Lee and Associates. Number two, contract for services with Paxton Park Golf Board, DBA, Paxton Park Municipal Golf Course. Number three, City of Paducah Comprehensive Annual Report for year ended June 30th, 2016. And number four, Museum of the American Quilter Society financial statements for years ended June 30th, 2016 and 2015.
Second.
City Clerk.
Commissioner Abraham.
Aye.
Commissioner Holland.
Aye.
Commissioner Rhodes.
Aye.
Mayor Pro Tem Wilson.
Aye. Commissioner Rhodes, if you'd read our first municipal order.
On the recommendation of the City Manager, the Board of Commissioners of the City of Paducah order that the personal changes on the attached list be approved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Good evening, Commissioner, City Manager. Any questions concerning personnel actions?
Nope. Thank you. City Clerk.
Commissioner Abraham.
Aye.
Commissioner Holland.
Aye.
Commissioner Rhodes.
Aye.
Mayor Pro Tem Wilson.
Aye. Commissioner Abraham.
I move that a municipal order entitled, a municipal order authorizing the mayor to execute an application and all documents necessary for a reimbursement grant for fiscal year 2017 in the amount of $37,288 through the Kentucky Office of Highway Safety for funding to be used for overtime hours associated with specific traffic enforcement and for the purchase of radar units for the Paducah Police Department be adopted.
Need a second?
I second.
Chief Barnhill.
Good evening, Mayor Pro Tem, Commission City Manager. This is our annual grant application. This year, as it was just read, it's for a total of $37,000. There is no match for this grant, and I kind of like to keep it in historical perspective. Over the last eight grant cycles, we've been awarded about $280,000 in this area. This obviously goes to offset those traffic problems that we have within the community.
Any questions?
No questions.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. City Clerk.
Commissioner Abraham.
Aye.
Commissioner Holland.
Aye.
Commissioner Rhodes.
Aye.
Mayor Pro Tem Wilson.
Aye. Commissioner Holland, please.
I move that a municipal order entitled a municipal order approving and authorizing the execution of a lease with Paducah Chiefs, Inc. for the leasing of 2400 Brooks Stadium Drive, Paducah, Kentucky, also known as Brooks Stadiums, be adopted.
Second.
Well, as we all know, last year was the inaugural season for the Paducah Chiefs, or the return, I guess you might say, and by all measures, it was a good success, and we're looking forward to the second year of that. Paducah Chiefs Incorporated exists in part to allow for a corporation to apply for a license from the city and the state to sell beer. So that's essentially what this is, and this is a follow-up to what was done last year.
I know that they had a successful year. I'm glad to hear that they're coming back. Looking forward to it. Any other questions?
Go Chiefs.
City Clerk.
Commissioner Abraham?
Aye.
Commissioner Holland?
Aye.
Commissioner Rhodes?
Aye.
Mayor Pro Tem Wilson?
Aye. We'll move into ordinances and adoptions. Commissioner Rhodes, please.
Okay, I move that the Board of Commissioners adopt an ordinance entitled, an ordinance extending the boundary of the City of Paducah, Kentucky by intent to annex certain properties lying adjacent to the corporate limits of the City of Paducah and defining accurately the boundaries of said properties to be included within the said corporation limits. This ordinance is summarized as follows. The approving of the intent to annex certain tracts of property contiguous to the present city limits located at 2901, 2905, Lone Oak Road, and 2825 Maryland Street containing 1.922 acres, more or less.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. Any questions? City Clerk?
Commissioner Abraham?
Aye.
Commissioner Holland?
Aye.
Commissioner Rhodes?
Aye.
Mayor Pro Tem Wilson?
Aye. Commissioner Abraham, if you'd read the next one, please.
I move that the Board of Commissioners adopt an ordinance entitled, an ordinance abolishing Division 16, Paducah Riverfront Development Authority of Article 4, City Administrative Bodies of Chapter 2, Administration of the Code of Ordinances of the City of Paducah, Kentucky, and creating an advisory board to be known as the Paducah Riverfront Development Advisory Board, providing for the appointment and terms of members, and establishing the role and purpose of said board. This ordinance is summarized as follows. The city hereby amends the Paducah Code of Ordinances to abolish Chapter 2, Article 4, Division 16, Paducah Riverfront Development Authority of the City of Paducah Code of Ordinances in its entirety. Further, the city hereby establishes an advisory board to be known as the Paducah Riverfront Development Advisory Board. The advisory board will assist and advise the Board of Commissioners in the development of civic projects and development plans which are intended to revitalize, improve, and generally enhance the Paducah Riverfront. It shall consist of 5 members who shall be appointed by the mayor with the approval of a majority of the members of the Board of Commissioners. The Board of Commissioners may designate one of its members as ex officio to the Paducah Riverfront Development Advisory Board.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any questions? City Clerk?
Mr. Abraham?
Aye.
Mr. Holland?
Aye.
Mr. Rhodes?
Aye.
Mayor Pro Tem Wilson?
Aye. City Manager, I don't think I asked you earlier if there were any additions or deletions.
There are none, Madam Pro Tem.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so really, we're here for tonight for a presentation on the next neighborhood revitalization report. And I want to express our appreciation to the Urban Renewal Community Development Authority for the work that they've done with the City Planning Department to prepare for this. So thank you. I know there's been a lot of time and effort to go into this and making the preparation. So we really appreciate all of that work that that authority has done with the Planning Department.
Absolutely. Great job.
Steve, we'll let you begin. And
thank you,
we'll,
Commission.
I'm sure we'll have plenty of questions afterwards.
Thank you, Commission and Mr. City Manager. I would also like to thank some of our URCDA board members that are actually here. Bob Wade's here, Chair Valerie Pollard, Calvin Shanks is here, and Japan Maskey was not able to make it tonight, but we do have 3 here in support. Before I actually get started with this presentation, if I could, I think Valerie would like to come up and just say a few words in advance.
Good evening, everyone. Good evening. I've been on urban renewal since I started actually working at the City of Paducah, well, and working with the board on our neighborhoods. And then after I left the city to open up a small business here in town, I came on the board. And with Mr. Wilson's retirement due to illness, Mr. Wilson was our guru and our person who knew everything. I have stepped in this past year as chair and tried to learn and do his best. The planning department has been very wonderful and to keep us informed on this neighborhood. In October of last year, actually last fall, Steve started talking and Charlie about what would be our next neighborhood. We got a van, we toured the neighborhoods, they took us all through to look at what the neighborhoods look like. And then that started the city's planning department. A couple of months ago, we got this whole big little notebook on something with everything, all this information on each neighborhood. We spent a lot of time discussing, and then in December, he sent us home with this book and a rating sheet, and we all rated and then came back in January to talk about it. We spent a lot of time talking about, we rated and then we spent a lot of time talking about each one, and Steve's going to go through that in a little bit. But the board members were pretty consistent on their ratings as far as the neighborhoods went. We took a lot of time in talking prior to this about what are the positives of each neighborhood and not necessarily, and weighing less on the deficiencies. It's very hard when you have a neighborhood, and you should have this, and you look at incomes that vary from $18,000 a year to about $38,000 a year. And when you go into a neighborhood, you go in to improve it. But in order to improve it, you have to have people who can, who you're not dislocating, who can afford to do the repairs, who can, you can find local investment, people who build homes and who do that. Private investment is what we call it, I believe, to do this. So we spent a lot of time. This is our recommendation Steve's going to go through. And we hope, if you have any questions or if you need anything else, please feel free. And thank you to our board members who show up and do this, and Charlie and Steve for all of their work. I think I knocked some of your stuff off.
That's all right. No,
that's it.
Thank you.
Is there anything else?
No, thank you.
You're welcome.
And I just want to say thank you so much for your hard work on this.
Thank you. It's been our pleasure.
Thank you, Valerie. In February of 2001, the commissioners adopted a strategic plan which declared vital neighborhoods were one of four primary goals for the city. This goal has proven to be primary focus for each successive city commission, and of course, we concentrated on the Lower Town neighborhood and then are finishing up the Fountain Avenue neighborhood at this time. As that neighborhood program reached its final year, which is this year, the URCDA and the Planning Commission were directed by you at a meeting held on August 16th, 2016 to analyze the next neighborhood, and that's what we've been doing for the last 4 months or so. Probably the first thing I'd like to do is kind of give you an idea of what the neighborhoods are. The first one I have up here is Glendale. Glendale is north of Park Avenue between the cemetery, and then over to the left is Noble Park. The next neighborhood is the Terrell Edition. Some people would probably remember this as with the original Fountain Avenue 1 plan called Fountain Avenue Phase 2. That's not really correct. It's the Terrell Edition historically by name. That area is from Park Avenue down to the bottom part of that map in between Monroe Streets and Jefferson Street over to 21st Street, and then borders Fountain Avenue Phase 1 on the east side or the right side of the map. The third neighborhood is actually a neighborhood that URCDA added. They wanted to review this neighborhood. Originally, we brought four neighborhoods to the City Commission. After those four neighborhoods were presented to URCDA, we received several letters asking about the Cole Park area, so we included in that in the analysis. The Cole Park, generally on the left-hand side of the maps, is Husband Streets. You see Island Creek on the right-hand side of the map. To the top of the map is Irvin Cobb Drive, and then it goes over towards 9th Street. Right in the center of that map is the Cole Park and the 6th Street corridor, which Rick just recently redid some infrastructure work. The Guthrie neighborhood is another neighborhood. It's roughly bound by Kentucky Avenue on the left-hand side. At the top of the map is 16th Street. You're looking on the bottom of the map is 21st Street. On the bottom right-hand corner, you can see Brooks Stadium, which you just spoke of a few minutes ago. And we'll get into the land use with some of that information is on that map in a few minutes. This is Frenchtown. Some people, I think, initially referred to it as Midtown, but historically it's referred to as Frenchtown, a portion of Frenchtown. It goes from roughly from 9th Street over to 13th Street. To the north would be Park Avenue, and then to the south, or the bottom part of the map, is Jefferson Street. You can see on the left-hand side of the map is where the Health Park is going, and then over on the right-hand side of the map at the top, that is the new Paducah Art School. The planning department initially reviewed four potential neighbors, and as I mentioned, we added the fifth neighborhood called Park. There were selection criteria scored, eight of them, for all five neighborhoods. The selection criteria was created to score the five neighborhoods. Each neighborhood was scored using 1 to 9, 1 being the best and 9 being the worst. A final neighborhood selection impact score was given to each of the five neighborhoods based on the average of all the criterion scores. URCDA members were asked to individually score each neighborhood utilizing the criteria and then come to a consensus on the impact score. The final URCDA meeting was held on January 3rd of this year. A total of 4 URCDA meetings were held in total, plus we spent one evening driving through all the neighborhoods. This is a look at the scoring criteria, with 1 being exceptional. This is for the 8 criteria, and 9 being poor. Staff was charged with the task of developing a set of criteria that can be used to evaluate the sustainability of the next neighborhood revitalization project. There are many neighborhoods within the city limits that could benefit from redevelopment efforts. Therefore, it is important that the selection process not only includes an assessment of a neighborhood's current conditions, but that also includes a comprehensive evaluation of the neighborhood's potential to have a sustainable and positive impact in the future. This set of criteria can be used to help ensure that the city's investment in housing, economic development, and infrastructure are maximized to the fullest extent and attract private investment that will improve the health and safety of the neighborhood that we select. Justifying public investment in a neighborhood that is reasonably good shape would be difficult to support. However, it may be just as ill-advised to invest in a neighborhood based solely on the number of abandoned houses, blighted properties, failing infrastructure, property levels, etc. With this in mind, the following criteria presented here were designed to put less weight on the deficiencies of a neighborhood and attempt to focus more on the available assets of a neighborhood and its potential for sustained growth and development. And that's very important. As you start going through this criteria, there's a lot of different ways you can go, but it's more about the sustainability, I think, of the neighborhood is something that we looked at. And I'll go through these 8 criteria next. The first criteria that we used was the number of neighborhood and or adjacent neighborhood assets. I think this is a picture, I believe, if that's of Cold Park. Are there existing assets in the neighborhood or adjacent neighborhood that would create confidence in the rehabilitation process, both public and private? That's very important to have the confidence to be part of that reinvestment. The next criteria is the ability to attract private reinvestment. Will private investment respond to governmental vision and investment? The last two neighborhoods that we worked on, that has happened towards the from halfway on through the latter part of those redevelopment processes, people are coming to us wanting to invest in those properties based upon that vision. And that's important for the sustainability of that neighborhood. Will the neighborhood be a place where people want to spend their own money? What makes that an attractive place for people to move? There's a lot of different places within our community that someone can decide to build a house. What makes that neighborhood a place where somebody would want to do that? The ability to obtain high comps. What are the comparative sales in adjacent neighborhoods? Are there new construction comps in adjacent neighborhoods? What are the comparative sales within the neighborhood? From experience, certainly in Fountain Avenue, we found one of the reasons it took halfway through the project to really get it moving is because we did not have comps where somebody could go out to a bank, borrow the money that they needed within that neighborhood to build a new house without gap financing from some form of government. I think we need to take a look at that as we move to the next neighborhood and look at which we've done, at what type of comps are within that neighborhood and what are adjacent, and that could certainly help out and kickstart the project as we move forward. Governmental capacity to attack neighborhoods, code enforcement, condition of houses. What's the infrastructure like? Infrastructure meaning curbs, gutters, sidewalks. What are the crime statistics? Proximities to schools, shopping, pharmacies, social services, and recreation. Those are those urban amenities that many people find attractive when they move into a community. Achievable rehabilitation costs, what's the size and the condition? These are all things that we analyzed, provided information to URCDA on. both from planning staff, but also through fire prevention. What type of positive spillover effect from adjacent neighborhoods? I've just listed some of those. There's the art school, which has just been completed. Noble Park is certainly an asset to the Glendale neighborhood. The health park is an asset to both Frenchtown and Lower Town as an asset. Fountain Avenue revitalization. The Sixth Street improvements I just spoke of that were just completed in Cole Park is an asset. Western Baptist Hospital expansion and the entire medical community in that area is an asset. This document that was shown earlier, within each one of these neighborhoods, there was a land use chapter as well as other data and maps that are associated with each one of these neighborhoods. And I'm really going to quickly go over the land use chapter for just one neighborhood, and that's Cole Park. You can see on the upper left, it talks about the number of parcels, residential vacancies, breaks those out. On the right, it tells you about the number of vacant parcels, the zoning, the comparative sales comps. I think it's hard to read, but I believe the five-year average in Cole Park was 22,000, which I'm going to show you in a second, is the lowest out of the five neighborhoods. And that's from those comps I was referring to earlier. Some of the characteristics, including, in Cole Park, there's 48% white, 52% minority. That's some of the census data that we had for each of the neighborhoods. How many are employed, unemployed or employed, education, income statistics were all included. I'm going to go ahead and read the overall housing stock rating because this is going to be primarily the same for each one, so it'll apply to all of them. Staff made a basic assessment of the overall condition of the existing housing stock within all the boundaries being considered for the next targeted revitalization community. The following evaluation of the condition of the existing housing stock in each neighborhood was based on several on-site visits to each neighborhood in order to assess the general condition of the housing stock and not based on a thorough house-to-house inspection of each structure. In addition to assessing the general condition of the houses within each neighborhood, staff took into account the average square footage of the neighborhood homes and commercial buildings in order to assess general rehabilitation cost. The neighborhoods were ranked 1 through 5 with a score of 1 to designate the best overall condition. You can see at the bottom, it says Fountain Avenue Phase 2, but that has changed. Frenchtown and Guthrie and Glendale were all 3. And then for housing stock condition, Cole Park was a 5. Terrell, I'm sorry, was a 2. Some of the mapping that was included in the document for urban renewal, there is a zoning map just giving the existing zoning within the neighborhood. Quite often when proceeding on with neighborhood revitalization, we'd want to take a comprehensive look at that and probably get rid of the 5 different zones that we have in that neighborhood and maybe bring that back down to 2, something that's more easily recognizable for the citizens that live in that community. We may even have some type of mixed-use areas depending upon what's existing within that corridor. Property valuation. This map shows within the last 5 years sales. And then gives you a comparative of square foot cost for the sales. And minority of the structures you see there are probably in the $20 to $40 square foot when a structure or a piece of property sold per square foot sales. Just a classification map delineates the residential from the commercial. And this one, Glendale, as you can see, it's primarily all residential and certainly has the highest density of any of the neighborhoods. There's very few vacant parcels within the Glendale compared to some neighborhood like Frenchtown, where there's in excess of 100 vacant lots at this time. We did an adjacent land use map. You start talking about those amenities. It's not amenities just within the neighborhood. We looked at all the amenities within a quarter mile of the neighborhood. What's out there on this one? It shows Juno Pharmacy. Certainly, you start getting into the Western Baptist Hospital complex, Eye Care Associates, many different types of services, Margaret Hank Presbyterian Church, but each neighborhood this was done for. We did an existing land use map for each of the neighborhoods. This is showing the Guthrie neighborhood. Obviously, along 16th Street, there's a lot of professional services. There's some engineering services, as well as several churches. There is a park, B Park, on the right side of the screen. And then down 16th Street, there's a variety of different types of commercial land uses also. This is, I believe I did send this out in a letter to you, is just a sample of the data that we took from all these various places and put on one sheet. Talks about the total land area. If you'll see the Cole Park being large, a lot of that is within the Island Creek watershed, where there are no houses and have been vacant for some time. The total number of parcels. And then it breaks it down from the residential, commercial, industrial parcels. There's also a code enforcement score in there. It ranges from 5.2 in Frenchtown, 5.3 in the Terrell Edition, up to 6.41 on Cole Park. That was done by our fire prevention based upon what they viewed as being the sheds and the structures, the condition of them, 6.41 being the worst, and the 5.2 being the least. Median household income is interesting. The Terrell Edition has a household income of $37,000. The Terrell Edition, the Frenchtown and Terrell Edition both have those numbers. That's because they're in the same census tract. If you look over at Cole Park, it's a little bit different. It's on the bottom side with an average median household income of $17,964. Percentage of vacant parcels. Cole Park is 40%. Glendale has 7%, as I spoke of earlier. It's very dense. The Terrell Edition, I believe, is 16%. At the bottom, it talks about owner-occupied, and I think this is important also. In Cole Park, it's 26%, and in Glendale, it's 42%. We've always mentioned in the past that we think 50 to 60% at least is a healthy number for homeownership within a neighborhood. There's different strategies you would work on both of those to get to that point. Also, the percentage of substandard structures are located within there. This was something we did afterwards. We did the comps within the neighborhood, but we wanted to go a little bit further out since I think these are used by our realtors also. We wanted a 5-year sales average for a quarter mile buffer around the entire neighborhood. And in the Terrell Edition, the average of all sales was 69,000. In Frenchtown, the average of sales were 79,000. You have to remember in the Terrell and Frenchtown, at that point, we're starting to get into Fountain Avenue Phase 1, where we've had the rehabilitations and had some sales. And certainly in Frenchtown, we're getting to both Fountain Avenue and we're getting into Lower Town, where the sales are much higher. The Glendale, the average of all sales is 59,000. Guthrie, 84,000. And Cole Park, average sales over the last 5 years is 22,000. All this brings us to the neighborhood criteria score. At the top, you can see there's the Terrell Edition, Frenchtown, Glendale, and Guthrie, and Kolb. Then with each one of those columns, there's four additional columns. Those four additional columns represent one of the urban rural community development members. If you remember at the beginning, I said that they independently ranked each one of these neighborhoods based upon a set of criteria, and then we met and went through all of our scores together. So from 1 to 9, 1 being the worst, the best, 9 being the worst, you can see how each one of them independently ranked each neighborhood. At the bottom, each one of their scores for a neighborhood was totaled, and then an average between the four URCDA members were given, and that's the very bottom number. So the final score after the process was Terrell Edition was a 21.75. The French Town was 31.5. Glendale, 34.5. Guthrie 38.5, and Cole Park 53.75, based upon the criteria that were outlined within the report. What next? I guess really direction from the commission, not asking for that tonight. Please take this information, and if you have further questions, please don't hesitate to contact us. At some point in the future, when that decision is made, we will be having neighborhood meetings. That's where we actually go out to the meeting, a minimum of five times meeting in churches or various places, and we meet with the residents and start asking those questions of, what do you like about your neighborhood? What are the positives? And then, what are the negatives? And then thirdly, the important part that quite honestly leads into our implementation strategy is, what would you like to see changed about your neighborhood? Then we'll start the preparation of the plan. From that, the implementation strategy, that will be based upon the goals and objectives. We'll probably have after that some public hearings for any codification changes. As I mentioned earlier, the zone change is a possibility. And then after that process, you actually get into the implementation of the plan. And that is my somewhat brief presentation. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
The neighborhood meetings, would they be held at what part, before a decision is made by the city commission or after?
Historically, we've done those after the commission has made a decision.
Is there any precedent for a preliminary meeting with each neighborhood before a decision is made?
There is no precedent for that, no ma'am.
Okay.
There's lots of different processes we could go about, but that has not happened in the past.
I'm wondering, sort of based on what you learned, now that we have two of these projects under our belt with Lower Town and Fountain Avenue, sort of based on the successes and challenges of those two neighborhoods, did that affect the way this process went at all?
This process has been different.
Okay.
We've been much more comprehensive about the development of this plan before we even get into a plan. I think the decision makers have had a lot more information on and making a recommendation to you all than what we've had in the past. But otherwise, actually, the planning process would be very similar.
But the decision-making process is more comprehensive than with Lower Town and Fountain Avenue?
As much information has been given up front before we even start the preparation of the plan, yes.
Okay.
Absolutely, yeah. Yes, we've learned a lot in the last 10 years about how important that private reinvestment is to make a neighborhood truly sustainable.
So that was weighed in heavily on this time, mm-hmm. the private reinvestment.
Yeah, and that's where I got back into the process when I spoke at some time about looking at the sustainability long-term of an area.
So the low number is the best. So that would put the Terrell addition as having the lowest.
That's correct.
Number, which is
That's
the
correct.
Highest ranking.
URCDA, through that process of ranking those criteria individually, the Terrell addition came out number one.
Well, I guess I'm confused as to best and worst. It's a sort of confusing usage of the term, because what you're really saying is they're not the worst as in the most need. When you say, do you see what I'm saying?
I absolutely do.
Yeah, it's really confusing. Can you walk us through what that really means when you say the, because you don't mean.
That may have been my term just used.
No, that's the term he used, I think.
Okay, if I can, yes, and I'm gonna, if I can read one thing again, I think that this really gets to it. There are many neighborhoods within the city limits that could benefit from redevelopment efforts. Therefore, it is important that the selection process not only includes an assessment of a neighborhood's current conditions, but that also includes a comprehensive evaluation of the neighborhood's potential to have a sustainable impact. If you were purely going by which neighborhood scored the lowest,
worst
across the board as far as housing condition, the median household incomes, all those things, it would be Kolb. Mm-hmm. But meeting these criteria on the ability to accomplish all the goals that we would have in the plan based upon a lot of these other factors, than it is the Terrell edition.
Yeah, because it's a confusing sort of argument to make that the neighborhood in the best condition is who we're arguing for needs revitalization. Inherently you kind of want to argue for the one in the worst condition, but what you're saying is that for the private reinvestment and the sustainability of the project, that's not really what you're arguing.
Well, yeah, exactly, but it's also the potential for sustained growth and development. As we go forward, this member I mentioned earlier in this process is that private reinvestment and the ability to attract private reinvestment. Certainly some neighborhoods, there could be federal and state grants where we would go in and assist in the development of new infill construction. But we can't do it all. To have that real positive impact in a neighborhood, there has to be, in my opinion, private reinvestment that partners with local government in meeting those goals and objectives of the plan. When you start saying that is how you start looking at the neighborhoods, where is the best possibility for that to occur? And there may be several of them, but this criteria kind of led us in the direction of where some of those things start getting answered.
Does this process help us understand, you know, if we say we picked the lowest score, but then what we're faced with is four other neighborhoods, one in particular that is in very rough condition. Does this process open up any sort of path forward for a neighborhood or a process, or now that we have this additional information, where we can help these neighborhoods that we just have all the statistics about what and how much they're struggling?
I think that would be a decision for the for the commission and the city manager on what it'd be the direction for our department to be based upon resources and both financial and human.
Are there other questions yet?
How difficult would it be? Now, no, we're just discussing 25,000 feet. That prior to deciding which neighborhood, what if you literally went back? And I would take some time and effort, but if you went back to the neighborhoods and said, look, we're going to have one meeting each neighborhood, and we're going to have that neighborhood sell us, why should we pick your neighborhood? And where I'm coming from is I'm on board with the story, but I mean, you may be surprised that some neighborhood you thought was just a great neighborhood just kind of poops out, and they're not very competitive, and you may say find a neighborhood that you thought was sort of a, you know, maybe a mid-pack, that boy, all of a sudden, I mean, you struck a chord, and they're there, and they're kind of noise, and they're excited about this. I mean, would it, what do you think?
Well, I think that would change the criteria. Because going with the criteria that they used led us here. Right. So if we change that, it may lead us to a different spot. So I guess the question really is,
are we going to accept just?
Do you want to change the criteria and do something different?
My guess is the five of us will have some different ideas.
Well, I think that, you know, what Commissioner Rhodes is speaking to is sort of the level of community engagement, which is much more difficult to grade than land use and sort of objective housing, land, structures, that sort of outlook, gauging the engagement of the community itself and the people in the community and not the buildings in the community is a
it is. Thing. And when you look at the point, the objective of revitalization for the city, we talk about how we lose, we're losing population. So one of the ways that this municipal has used to create that, because we're pretty much landlocked, so we revitalize neighborhoods to get that private investment so folks want to move into our city. So if that's the objective, then this is why this criteria was put together. So now if we want to change that, and that's fine, we can talk about that, but understanding that the criteria was met, which would invite private investment like what happened in Fountain Avenue, Lower Town. So just want to make sure we understand why this was put together.
Because in both of those neighborhoods, it did increase the population.
Yes.
Significantly, mm-hmm. Both of those. And what criteria similar to this was used for both of those?
I'm sorry? No.
This is totally new this. But it's based on your studies of what would That's ensure correct. Success
yeah,
in the neighborhood that was selected.
Yeah. Those decisions on neighborhood happened early in past, yeah. And then a lot of the research was done afterwards. Mm.
Intended
to, quite frankly, maximize reinvestment in the properties. So the city is effectively providing incentives for reinvestment in property, whether it be an existing structure or vacant lot. But ultimately, the large majority of the investment over time will come privately. So it's hard to kind of make assumptions on what might happen. So the attempt here, quite frankly, is to put some science to it based on a couple of decades of experience in a couple of neighborhoods. And I think in conversations with Steve, especially in Fountain Avenue, when that started out, it took a while to build up momentum because there needed to be buy-in on people's parts and understanding of where the benefit might be and the return on that investment. And it's kind of like once it built a certain amount of momentum, it really took off. Point of, by the time we got to last year, 8 or 9 years of the program, a lot of stuff started happening entirely privately, which is ultimately our goal, I think, for a limited role in something. And it really shows that it, at the end of the day, was a huge success.
I think you did this on one of the previous charts, but we got a truncated one printed out to us. Was there, in the table you had, was it sort of an attempt to show us how these, how the neighbors looked in Fountain Avenue before we started? Or did I dream that? Was there?
I think the one you received in your letter last week, maybe.
No, we don't have the Fountain Avenue phase one in our, but it looked like your table had, on the few slides back.
It did.
Had.
It did.
Yeah, so this is what these numbers were,
yeah,
like.
Yeah, just kind of give you an idea,
okay,
what Fountain Avenue phase one is compared to these other neighborhoods.
Do we have any numbers like that on Lower Town?
Not offhand, I don't know. Charlie, were these numbers that you included on Fountain Avenue Phase 1, was that pre?
Yeah, that was 07.
Okay, thank you.
06 or 07.
So that would be
where we started.
Yeah. And the owner occupancy at that time, you see down there, was 35%. It's probably over 60% now, 60 to 70%.
It started at 36, and Terrell is at 41.
One figure that might be inflated for Fountain Avenue Phase 1 is the 80%.
That's what I was just about to ask about.
No, you read my mind. I think someone was making a point there, but that's what was put forward in the
I've always used that number, quite honestly.
Yeah.
I mean,
when
you
start looking at
it, it's still high compared to the
Yeah, place. I mean, it, the Fountain Avenue Phase 1, we started it, a substantial number of those structures were in dilapidated condition.
Yeah.
I mean, because if you cut 80% in half, you're still higher than
mm-hmm.
Cold.
And I would almost, and some of those other numbers that you see across there may be a little bit low, but.
Can you go back to the map, the Terrell edition, one that,
I think
it was
at
the very beginning, that. There, okay.
I can use this one or I can go back. There's other ones.
This is fine. I just wanted to understand where it is exactly. The circle is Fountain Avenue and the Lang Park.
Yes, ma'am.
So this is up from the other part of Fountain Avenue. In my brain, I thought
it's
connecting.
West. It's west of the existing mm-hmm. Fountain Avenue Phase 1.
So is it Frenchtown that sort of connects
in between Lower Town and
Fountain Avenue
Phase 1, that's correct. Whoops. There's, you know, Frenchtown. You see the health park on the left mm-hmm. and the art school on the right.
Frenchtown is basically 13th Street mm-hmm. back to the railroad. Mm-hmm.
Can you go back to that one on the Terrell? That map? Okay. I think the first one at the beginning was maybe a little bit clearer exactly where it is.
Terrell. See, let's go back. Terrell goes back to like, what's it, about 18th Street?
21st.
That's right. Of course. Thank you. I'm sorry.
Right. And as I've mentioned before, after the directions given, the actual implementation strategy will vary across the board on which direction we go based upon all these different types of characteristics. You know, you start looking at, Frenchtown, for instance, there's only 108 residential parcels, and there's 100-plus vacant parcels. There'd be a major infill strategy if that one was chosen. So each neighborhood is different across the board.
So I know with Fountain Avenue and Lower Town, there were a lot of incentives given, some from the city. I think Lower Town and the local bank participate.
Yeah, different.
So we would look at trying to develop some programs like that.
It would depend on what the final direction is what our implementation strategy turns out to be. Certainly in Lower Town, it was before some of the new regulations in banking, where Paducah Bank had a little bit more freedom to lend money up front to help artists out in the rehabilitation of those structures. That changed with Fountain Avenue Phase 2. That's why those comps is so important for investment, whether it be public or private. It's just changed.
So there were also those house plans that were developed that people mm-hmm. could ready-make.
Yeah,
can those be used in the next?
Absolutely. It depends. At the very beginning of that process, we had a local designer go out, Charlie and I, and we started driving through the neighborhoods of neighborhoods that were developed between 1920, 1930, 1910, started looking at those characteristics that we liked, including in Fountain Avenue Phase 1, and then we had a set of about 13 houses, I believe, or so designed, pre-approved downstairs. That was part of the incentive package, and it was used quite a bit. But it was, raised front porches, the siding materials was considered, and the whole idea of that was if it was, whether it was a local government constructed project or private infill, when we got done with it, I wanted it to blend in, and whoever purchased that house and lived in that house felt privileged and honored to live in that house. It meant something to them, so we paid a lot of attention to design and materials.
But some of that could still be used.
Absolutely. But we probably add some more to it, depending on the characteristics of the neighborhood. For instance, in the Terrell Edition, although it's adjacent, when you get on the other side of 17th Street, some of the houses start to become a little bit smaller compared to going the other direction towards Harahan, where you've got the four squares that are 3,000 and 4,000 square feet. So, we'd probably add some new design into that, maybe a little bit smaller, some smaller house designs, I don't know, but that would fit into the neighborhood. But there again, that would lower the construction cost, which could make the project move a little bit quicker. And the rehabilitation cost in that neighborhood are going to be lower because the structures are lower in Fountain Avenue. Rehabilitation cost, the last house we were looking at was, upwards of $300,000, so, because the structures are so large. And the cost of rehabilitation quite often is the same cost as new construction if you do it right.
Can I ask about the criteria governmental capacity to attack neighborhood problems?
Yeah. Really infrastructure, those types of things. Some of the things I'm just talking about, certainly we have limited resources, and we have to point those limited resources towards certain aspects of the neighborhood, whether it be incentives or things like that. When you start talking about infrastructure, it's quite expensive quite often. What is our capacity to make changes if it's really needed? Some neighborhoods may not need as much, others need more infrastructure improvements.
So a one would say we have a really good capacity to help the infrastructure code enforcement problems in this neighborhood.
Yeah, it's really a lot of things. It's both housing, infrastructure. It's just looking at the whole package. Okay. What is our capacity to take this on?
Because Valerie's right, the numbers are pretty close, except for in Cole Park on that one, and there's a pretty wide variance, so that's why I was asking. Yeah.
Well, and that's interesting when you start looking at the household median income in Cole Park. You look at the home ownership rate, which is 25%. You're talking about a lot of nuisance code enforcement, and then you're talking about local, state, or federal grants to help offset the cost of the rehabilitation of that 26% based upon the family median income.
Mm. Any other questions? Commissioner Abraham? Commissioner Rhodes? Thank you.
Thank you so
very much,
Stephen. Thank you.
Thanks again to the authority, Valerie, and all of your group. Thanks for being here tonight. Thank you for all your hard work. If you want to add something, that'd be fine. Come on up.
I think our understanding as a board is that the city commission tasked us to make a recommendation on the neighborhood. Mm-hmm. And I know you guys have all the scoring, but our unanimous recommendation was for the Terrell Edition and not based on it being the best quality neighborhood or the worst quality neighborhood, but having the most likelihood of being a successful project. So don't think in terms of those numbers as one means the houses are better and nine means the houses are worse, but look at it in terms of one means that we felt that the, like I said, the highest chance for success of that neighborhood moving forward. So that's, those are those numbers mean. They're not a rating of quality.
Mm-hmm. Right. Oh, right. We understand. All right, I do. I think
okay,
everyone does.
Just making
does.
Sure, because yes. The stuff I'm hearing, I keep hearing this stuff rotated of worst and best neighborhoods based on financial numbers maybe, and that mm-hmm. we looked at that, but that the final scoring had not necessarily a lot to do with that.
Right. It has the best level of success
right.
to be successful.
Correct. Correct.
Thank
okay.
you.
Thank you.
Valerie, Bob, any of y'all have any other? Thank you so much. Appreciate your hard work.
Oh, man.
So, Commissioner, I mean, you want to just, before we go to comments, talk anything more about the next steps with that?
No, our purpose tonight was to make a presentation. I want to especially say thanks Steve tonight because I know he's under the weather and not feeling well. So thank you, Steve, for being here. We had a unfortunate discovery occur within the last 10 days or so. So dealing with a roof on a building that the city owns, and it's a significant replacement item. So I've asked Rick to come forward tonight and share a little bit of information on that.
Have you moved into city manager report?
I'm sorry, I did. Thank you.
Okay, well, I want to back up to the other, though.
Okay.
Are there any other steps that we need to be thinking about? What's the timing on it based on the report that was given tonight?
I think what we'd like to know, I guess, at some point is if this methodology is okay with you and if we should proceed forward with some kind of an action item on the recommendation. And then pursue the action steps that Steve sort of outlined from there. So if you want to do something different, we would need to know that. So unless we hear differently, the process or sequence would be to come forward with a order, municipal order, resolution, whatever it is, to adopt a neighborhood mm-hmm. so that staff could proceed with all the steps that we would take to begin the process.
So do we have an implementation target for the next neighborhood sometime 2017?
Well, I think we're in the last fiscal year where we've allocated funds specifically for Fountain Avenue. So I think budgetarily we've anticipated that the next project would begin to be funded next year in our budget, which begins July 1. So some of those prep steps, the planning and hooking up with the residents and figuring out the approach and the priorities and all that thing could be going on prior to the time that funding actually became available for the selected neighborhood.
Any other questions on that? Okay, city manager's report.
Sorry. Rick is going to share with you some information about a roof replacement issue that we learned about in the last few days.
Mayor Pro Tem, City Manager, and Commission. The last windstorm, you recall here a few weeks ago, we had a lot of high winds that came through, and this happens to be the roof on the Siemens Church building that we own, but we have a lease to Siemens Church there. And this is what is referred to as a membrane roof, and typically the way the membrane roofs work, it's like a thick body of rubber that is just a blanket on top of the roof. There's insulation underneath it. And basically this glues down and then it goes up what we call a parapet wall. That's the wall that goes around the outside of the building. And then it sheds water to the roof scuppers and they carry the water off. The wind that we had came, I guess, a blowing by. And it creates a vacuum sometimes based on how the roof is. And it actually lifted the roof up, which delaminated the stickiness of it. It's not sticking to the insulation underneath it. And right arrow key or what? Down arrow key or what?
Use the mouse and hit that right arrow.
Use the mouse and use the right arrow. That one. Okay, that one. Okay. And you can see off in the corner there in the distance, you can see how it's raised up. But the thing that raises the most attention, when you're looking at this, it looks like it'll shed water. It'll shed water for a little while. But you see those things, those little raised areas up in the middle of the roof? That's actually fasteners that hold the insulation down, and when the roof raised up, it raised the fasteners. Now, if that gets a snow load on it, then those fasteners become ice picks, and they puncture through. So, you know, that's what we're having to deal with. So Randy Crouch, your maintenance superintendent that has responsibilities here, I asked him, he showed me this and said, Rick, we got a problem. He showed me this. I said, go get us some quotes. We have quotes from professional roofers that do this line of work, and they've all been on the roof. Two of them have been on the roof. I said, is there any in between? Is there anything that we can do here that would work? And the two that's been up there says no, because of that delamination, because if we have wind again, it's going to suck it up again, and those things there are potential punctures, snow load on that, and then we have the roof or the tenant in a situation where they can't function if it's raining inside their building. So I've got quotes that are just shy of $100,000 upwards to $135,000 for four different, that's a range between the four that we've got. And this is something that we probably need to address quickly. And from a funding source, I've actually looked at our finances, and we can, I guess, cobble together the money to do this through various accounts. We have a building account, we have an operations building account, we have a rental account that are monies that we can pull from to do this, and we can get this done, but it's not something that needs to be, you know, we need to get on it this time of year.
Who are the bidders?
I knew you was going to ask that. We got Southern Roofing, Atlas Roofing, Mentor Roofing, and Swift Roofing.
The other issue here, in addition to the cost, is that this is not budgeted for. So I have the authority under municipal code to proceed to do this if the money's there, and then bring forward a municipal order to get your approval. Post-contract let, or we could proceed with a proper action item to get the commission's appropriation and then proceed. I think it's going to come down to the timing here a little bit. We're really in a position where we don't have a lot of choice here. There are occupants within the building that are leaseholders of the city. So in this time of year, it can rain, and certainly as we go forward, it there's more. So
there's one thing I failed to include in my, I guess, discussion there. This roof is 17 years old, and the warranty on the roof was 15 years. So one thing we'll get out of this is the proper repair or the proper replacement will gain a minimum of 15 year warranty on the roof, and anything we do in between, if we were, we wouldn't gain anything.
Are those Swifts out of town, Air Murray?
Yes, sir.
Southern, the rest are all local.
Let's see. Southern is in Paducah. Of course, Atlas is in Paducah.
And Mentor
is in Benton. Well, at least their stationary shows Benton. And then Swift is in Murray. Yes, sir.
So
you need
information on
direction?
Well, unless there are any questions about the need to do this, we would proceed one way or the other. But in our opinion, we need to do it, and that reflects the assessment of multiple roofing professionals. So,
okay.
Good day.
All right. Anything else on the city manager's report?
Yeah, a couple things.
You want to turn the lights back on?
We have some work being done by the city attorney's office looking at the prospect of moving from the use of ordinances to municipal orders for certain classifications of business or action items that come before you. We have traditionally used municipal orders for that, among other things, require two reads. They also require publication, whereas municipal orders are a single read, publication's not required. So there'll be something coming back from there in the near future that I think I'm optimistic is going to produce the opportunity to consider doing some business maybe a bit more efficiently and perhaps even reducing the number of meetings that are needed over a year's period of time. Excuse me, my lungs aren't the best tonight either, so I'm running out of breath quick, but I'll continue here. Recently at the Academy for Kentucky League, the last couple of weeks, I was reminded again, and commissioners there either became aware of or were reminded that the city is and has been in need, of recodifying its ordinances. This is something that we've had an awareness of for some time and, in fact, budgeted money for in this year's budget. And the clerk's office had previously solicited proposals from codifiers for that work. So those are under review, and we'll be moving forward with that shortly. And what that essentially does is that the ordinances, our ordinances, are reviewed for compliance with state and federal statutes, and they are reorganized, a new index made, and all that kind of thing. Obviously, there's commission action required to recodify and readopt the ordinances. There's also the opportunity to consider ordinance revisions content-wise, and for the codification service, we will also get recommendations or suggestions from the codifier for ordinances that appear perhaps to be no longer relevant, and that'll give us a basis to take a look at those and consider changes. I think at that point in time, it also makes sense, and quite frankly, ideally, the way to do this is a comprehensive review of the ordinances, and I've done this before, and it usually starts with the departments reviewing ordinances that they have responsibility for administering, in particular, to determine if there are some modernization opportunities, perhaps some condensing and that kind of thing. But that's a pretty involved process. That is an organization-wide process that the timing for that to engage full tilt is not really good right now. So I'm attracted to the opportunity for the codification company to perhaps tag suggested ordinance for us to look at after they've done their review. So it's a sensible way, and I think a manageable way to approach that.
So they tag each, the ones they feel are in need of modernization, and then that would go to the departments to review?
I think it would be for us to determine what kind of process to start at that time. Typically, I mean, the way I've done it before is, departments to review for relevance or workability, those kind of things, and then some kind of process involving the commission to bring those forward for suggestions and vetting for changes. It's a big process, particularly if it's attempted comprehensively in one. So I think there are some issues that I want to think through and work through of manageability for that. But if in the process of recodification to get our ordinance book legally up to speed and everything else, if the codifier can start that process by tagging some ordinances that, by virtue of the experience they do working with 350 code books around the country, they've got an ear and an eye to be able to kind of, you know, see something like, you know, the proverbial no spitting off the bridge ordinance, or what, you know, commonly are referred to as blue laws, or those kind of things. So I think that's a good, sensible start to that, and I'd like to do that and then pick up with that with a more involved process. Last thing I will mention is negotiations with both the firefighters union and the police union are well underway, and we're making good progress, and we look forward to bringing contract proposals forward to you in the next few weeks. And that's all I have.
Thank you. Any commissioner report comments?
I'd just like to say, as the newly elected attorney, I'm very excited about the codifying and modernization and all that. I know it's not exciting stuff, but it's important.
It is.
We can be carrying ice cream cones in our pockets upside down.
I'm sure there's a thing
there
or
is.
Two in there that's maybe in those categories, but
I think it's always that's really long overdue to do that, and it is a major deal to do it. But also I just want to comment on last Saturday afternoon, early evening. It was so many people downtown. The municipal parking lot was packed. There were people walking up and down. Of course, the temperature was 65 degrees.
Yeah.
I know there was the bridal show was going on,
mm-hmm.
But there was a lot of folks. There was a lot of folks out. So that really looked good.
Look forward to the Riverfront.
Heck yeah.
Opening up so we can expand on down.
Heck yeah.
Anything else, Mr. Rhodes?
Mr. Trump said this morning that he's going to knock out 75% of the red tape for business. I thought we could, shoot for some maybe smaller, more accomplishable percentage than 75%. But
I would hope there'd be a trickle down effect because a lot of what we do because the feds have something to say about it. So maybe that'll happen.
Maybe it'll happen.
Well, in Kentucky, you can go to redtapereduction.com.
Right.
I think there are
that's right.
Regs that you want reviewed to be struck down and enter it in. I hope we have done that about the bubble, only can keep it up so many months. I hope that that's been turned in for a review where it can be kept up for a longer period of time.
I think you did. I think that's a good one.
All right. Anything else? Any public comments?
Any public.
All right. Thank you. Meeting's adjourned.